Today we'll gonna see what is mean by column base and how to design column base. Particularly we'll see how to design slab base. So at the end of this session, students will be able to understand what is mean by column base and the design of slab base. So first of all, we'll see why do we require column base. Here we have one I section, which is a column, and we have to transfer this load from this I section to the concrete footing. So for this, we are having the load is very much higher and the bearing pressure of concrete is very much less, which is of the order of 0.45 fck, and here we are having the maximum load. So for the small area, this will going to be failed by punching. So we have to increase the area, and for that we'll use base plate. Basically we have to increase the area, and to increase the bearing area we'll go for base plate. So the column concrete footing will going to remain safe with the help by using the base plate. Basically there are two types of column bases. One is a slab base and another one is our gusset base. Its suitability is, slab base is used for the light load and gusset base is used for the heavy loads. The bearing pressure here we get is a uniform bearing pressure. Here we don't get a uniform bearing pressure. The full load is transferred by the bearing concrete, that is full load is transferred to the concrete by bearing action, and here 50% load is transferred by the gusset plate and 50% load is transferred by the bearing action. We have to design this gusset plate and gusset angle. Here we will provide a nominal cleat angle for the bolted connection, or if we use welded connection we'll weld this section. For light loads we'll use the slab base, for heavy loads with moment or eccentric load we'll use the gusset plate. Load is transferred by 100% bearing, load is transferred by 50% gusset plate and 50% by the bearing action. We are particularly see what is mean by slab base. We'll see its design steps, and after that we'll see the gusseted base. So we'll see some theoretical background. It is a slab base. It is assumed that the maximum bending moment occurs at the edge of the column. Here we'll see, this is the edge. The maximum bending moment will occur at this edge of the column. As the slab slab tends to bend simultaneously about the two principal axes of the slab, the stress caused by bending about one axis is influenced by the stress due to bending about the other axis. And due to this effect, we'll use a Poisson ratio of 0.3 to account this effect. Now we'll see the bending moment, how to calculate the bending moment. First of all, we'll take an 1 mm strip of the slab projection along the xx axis. Along the xx axis means parallel to xx axis. This is our xx axis. This is our xx axis. Moment is load multiplied by length, it's a UDL, multiplied by L by 2, we'll get the moment. So WA square by 2. And along the YY axis means parallel to YY axis, we'll get the maximum bending moment will be equal to W into length, W into B, acting at a distance of L by 2, which is B by 2, which is equal to WB square by 2. Here we get the net moment, MX, coming WA square by 2, measure about XX axis, and considering the Poisson effect, we'll subtract some value, its effect on another axis, WA square by 2 minus 0.3 WB square by 2. This is our Poisson's ratio. And taking W by 2 common, we'll get this value, W by 2 into A square minus 0.3 B square. Now the moment capacity of the plate MP will be equal to 1.2 Fy into Ze, where Ze is the elastic section modulus of the plate. So for 1 mm strip, the elastic section modulus will be equal to 1 into T square by 6. We'll put up some all the values, which is equal to 1.2 Fy into T square by 6, where T is the thickness. Now, previously we get this value W by 2 A square minus 0.3 B square, and we have considered the moment of the plate, that is the moment capacity of the plate, which is equal to 1.2 Fy into T square by 6. We'll equate both these and we'll find the value of T. But before that, we'll apply a partial safety factor for material, which is gamma M naught. Now, and then we'll equate these two values to find the value of T. Here, cutting all the values, it is divided by 2, which is equal to 3. Then we'll multiply, it is going to in the numerator, it will come into denominator. So T square will be equal to 6 by 2 into W divided by 1.2 A square minus 0.3 B square. After solving this, we get T square is equal to 2.5 W into A square minus 0.3 B square gamma M naught divided by Fy. Now T will be equal to under root of this section. We'll get under root 2.5 W into A square minus 0.3 B square into gamma M naught divided by Fy. This is partial safety factor for material. This is the yield strength. This is the smaller projection. This is the longer projection. We'll see each and every term. This is now we'll see the design procedure. First of all, we'll assume a suitable grade of concrete. Whatever we are using, we'll take that grade of concrete, and depending upon the grade of concrete, we'll find its bearing strength. That is the bearing strength of concrete, which is given by 0.45 FCK. A reduced value of 0.45 FCK is used. We have the maximum value as 0.6 FCK, which is recommended by the code, but code says we have to use a reduced value, which is equal to 0.45 FCK. We get the value of stress. Now to find out the area, what is mean by area? Area is nothing but load divided by stress, where P is the factored load of the column, the load which is coming on the column, and the bearing strength of concrete, which is the stress, available stress, or the permissible bearing strength of the concrete. We'll get the required area of the base plate. We'll see each and every term here, where L is this one, L is the length of the base plate, B is the width of the base plate, D is the depth of the column, this A is the longer projection of the base plate, and B is the smaller projection of the base plate. We have got the value of area. Now to find out the sides, we'll assume the square base plate, and the length and width of the square base plate is calculated by this equation. And to achieve the economy, some designers feel that projection should be equal. So they maintain A, which is equal to B. If you put A equal to B, we get some value. We can find out the value of A and B by this equation. D is the depth of column, B is the smaller projection, BF is the width of the flange, A is the longer projection, and area. We'll assume A equal to B and we'll find out the projection. We get this from column. We'll see design steps. Now the intensity of pressure, we can find out by this equation. W is equal to P by A1, where A1 is nothing but area of the base plate provided in mm square. If you put this value in mm square, we get the value of W, intensity of the pressure from concrete under the slab base, in Newton per mm square. We'll compare it with the bearing capacity of concrete. If it is less, then it is okay. After that, we'll find out the thickness. Now the minimum thickness of the base, minimum thickness T of the slab base is calculated from the equation number 6. It should not be less than the thickness of the column flange. What is equation number 6? We'll see. This is the equation number 6. We'll calculate the thickness of the base plate with the help of this equation, and we'll check it with the thickness of flange. If it is less, then it is okay. And for the slab base, we'll provide 2 to 4 numbers of holding down bolts of 20 mm diameter. When the base is subjected only to the axial compressive force, 2 bolts will be enough. If it is not subjected to the axial compressive force, we'll provide 4 holding down bolts. And welded, if it is subjected to some movement, then welded joint we have to design for the column and the base plate. Note, if the column and base have machine end and perfect bearing is ensured, the axial load is assumed to be transferred directly and welding is designed for moments only. However, if the perfect bearing cannot be ensured, the column should be welded to the base plate for all the forces. That is, we have to design the welding. If it is subjected to 100 perfect bearing, then we have to just provide the nominal welding. Next, it is assumed that the bearing pressure are uniformly distributed all over the contact surfaces. The bottom of the column and the supporting surface of the base are machined so that the complete compressive load is transferred to the plate by direct bearing. This is a base plate. Next, we'll see some review question. You can pause the slide and answer these questions. The thickness of the base plate is determined from option A, the flexural strength of the plate. Next, shear strength of the plate. C, bearing strength of the concrete pedestal. Next is punching criteria. You can find out the thickness on which basis. Next question, the minimum thickness of a rectangular slab base is calculated. Just now we have seen one equation for the calculating the thickness of a rectangular slab base. You just see which equation we have used. Now, these are the review answers of the review question. The thickness of the base plate is determined from the flexural strength of the plate. We have considered the bending about two axes. We have considered the Poisson effect on another axis, that is WA square by 2 minus 0.3 WB square by 2. That is the flexural strength of the plate. And minimum thickness of a rectangular slab is, we have calculated T is equal to under root 2.5 W gamma M naught upon Fy into A square minus 0.3 B square. So these are the standard terms. Fy is the yield stress of the steel, W is the uniform pressure, A is the moment, and A and B are the cantilever projection, smaller and longer projections. These are my references. Thank you.